Blackstone Publishing presents The Cat Who Wasn't a Dog by Marian Babson. This book is read by Sarah Nichols. Chapter 1. If you ask me, Dame Cecile Savoy was overdoing it. Chewing the scenery, in fact. I'm as sympathetic as the next person, providing the next person isn't Evangeline, but she was beginning to set my teeth on edge. I mean, widow's weeds were all very well in their day, I suppose, but I can't imagine where she'd even found any in this day and age. They must have been left over from some ancient theatrical production, East Lynne, perhaps, especially that long, all-enveloping, rusty black cloak. The draped black veil concealed her face. Judging by the whimpering, snuffling noises coming from behind the veil, that was probably a mercy. From time to time, a black-gloved hand holding a black-bordered handkerchief slipped under the veil to dab at streaming tears. Evangeline rolled her eyes at me, and I rolled mine back. We were both trying to ignore the inert body in the pet carrier on the jump seat facing us. Dame Cecile had adamantly refused to allow it to be placed in the boot. It was going to be a long day. "Now then!" Eddie shut the door on us and climbed into the driver's seat. We had hired his taxi for the day to take us down to Brighton from London.
"Where to? The pet cemetery, is it? I don't have the knowledge down here. You'll have to tell me where—"
"Stuff yours,"
Dame Cecile said in a muffled voice.
"Eh?"
Eddie turned to look over his shoulder at us. His eyebrows would have disappeared into his hairline if he'd had a hairline.
"That's not very nice." "Stuff yours," Dame Cecile repeated.
"Now, now, Cecile," Evangeline said, between clenched teeth. "We realize you're distraught and it's all terribly sad, but after all, the dear creature was about 250 years old in human terms. It isn't as though it were cut down in its prime."
"Stuff yours!"
"In any case," Evangeline decided to be pedantic about it, "I believe the correct expression is up."
"Stuff yours!"
Dame Cecile trumpeted, in a voice that would have rattled the opera glasses in the chair backs of the second balcony.
"Stuff yours, the taxidermist, you fool!"
The day was going to be even longer than I had thought. It had all started with that telephone call yesterday morning. Someday I'm going to train myself to stop answering the phone. But I had been expecting a call from my daughter, Martha, who had been hinting for days that she was soon going to have something wonderful to tell me, and so I took the call.
"Hello? Hello?"
At first, I thought the person on the other end of the line was underwater. The strange gasping, gulping, bubbling noises sounded more as though they emanated from a faulty water supply pipe in an aquarium than from any human source.
"You want to speak to Evangeline?"
I guessed wildly. "Who's calling, please?" It didn't sound like a call she'd be delighted to receive.
"Let me talk to her."
The voice found itself and became almost coherent.
"I'm desperate. I need human warmth, sympathy, understanding,"
it wailed.
"And you want Evangeline?
She must be desperate, or else there was some other Evangeline in the city. What number are you calling?"
"Trixie, stop playing the fool and put me through."
The momentary whiplash of command in the voice, which was beginning to sound familiar, was ruined by several more hoo-hoos and sniffs.
"This is an emergency."
"On your head be it," I muttered, and called out, "Evangeline, it's for you."
"At this hour?"
It was barely 10 a.m., and although we were both up, we weren't really functioning yet. Just sitting around waiting for the caffeine in the first cup of coffee to kick in enough to enable us to pour ourselves a second cup.
"She said she wants—"
This was no time to repeat the warmth and sympathy routine. "She wants to speak to you." Evangeline snatched the phone from me with a dirty look, as though I had been personally responsible for engineering the call just to annoy her.
"Who is it?"
she snapped.
"Do you know what time it is, or hasn't anyone explained the big hand and the little hand on the clock to you yet?"
Well, it was warm enough, I supposed, practically sizzling, in fact, but somehow I doubted that it was quite what the caller had had in mind. Unusually for Evangeline, there was a long silence while the other person held forth.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.